All right, I hope you have your Bible with you. Please grab it and open it to James chapter 1, verse 2. James chapter 1, verse 2. I think it was Mark Twain who said, "The man who does not read good books has no advantage over the man who cannot read good books." In other words, if you can read but you don't, you have no advantage over those who are illiterate. If we are readers, then we need to read. I love books. I have hundreds of half-read books in my office. I don't know if you have many of those in your house. I seldomly finish a book all the way to the end. If a book is good enough to maintain my attention all the way through, I usually recommend it to people, and I do that periodically. One of the books that I read all the way through many years ago was a book by Mortimer Adler called How to Read a Book. I don't know if you've ever seen this book or not. It's actually a classic. It was written over 50 years ago, and Adler basically teaches us how to read. And there's a whole section in this book about genre. Genre. Now, what is genre, you say? I mentioned to my dad in an email this week that I was preaching on genre in Scripture, and he sent me this back. This will give you a little glimpse into our relationship. He said, "Pete, not everyone knows exactly what a genre is, but as is usually the case when we are unclear about anything but are reluctant to show it, we utilize a foreign word to clarify this confusion. Words that come to mind include angst, used when a state of undifferentiated panic is experienced, or déjà vu, when we have forgotten what we have just remembered, but then vaguely we recollect that we have forgotten something." I don't know why I shared that with you. I just thought it was kind of interesting. So he does know what genre means. Genre is a style that brings with it its own rules of reading. Let me say that again. Genre is a style of writing that brings with it its own rules of reading. There are different genres of writing. There are different ways, different styles of writing. And each of those different styles have different rules for reading, different rules for interpretation. Let me give you some examples. I've got a few books on my desk here. And these all represent different genres of writing and reading. And so we'll start over here in this corner. This is a practical book. It's an SAT study book. Some of you are getting ready to take the SAT. It's a practical book like a cookbook or like a driver's ed manual or something like that. And practical books basically present rules or steps that you need to take in order to achieve something that is a goal for you. They're very straightforward. There's no nuance. There's no imagery. There's no double meaning. It's just what you see is what you get. That's a practical book. This is one of my favorite books in the last 10 years. It's by Dan Rome. It's called The Back of a Napkin. The Back of a Napkin. This is an example of an expository book. In expository books, they're very explicit. They teach you something very specific. They don't use flowery language. They have one specific meaning. The goal is to convey knowledge. I know something, I want you to know it. So what Rome conveys in this book is how to draw pictures on the back of a napkin so that you can solve problems and sell things and all that kind of stuff. If you like drawing, it's just an awesome book. It's an example of an expository book. This is an example of a story. It's a little book called War and Peace by Leo Tolstoy. It is a fantastic story. Adler will tell you, ideally, when reading story, otherwise known as narrative or novels, to read the story in one sitting. Good luck with this one on that. Obviously, you can't do that with all of them. But the reason he says that is because you want to immerse yourself in a story. You want to dive in and you want to go to that place because story takes you to a different world and gives you different experiences that you can never experience otherwise. This is a book by J.R.R. Tolkien called The Fellowship of the Ring. It's another example of story, but a different type. It's called imaginative writing. Imaginative writing. If an expository book is attempting to convey knowledge to you, imaginative books are trying to convey experience to you. It wants you to experience something, so the language is much more ambiguous. There's multiple layers to the communication. Imaginative books are great books to do in a group study because you can dive into the secondary and tertiary meanings behind the story, like the Fellowship of the Ring. This is a book of poetry. Poetry. I'll be honest with you, I don't quite get poetry. I've tried really hard. I've read it and I've tried. I am just of the opinion that if you want to say something, just say it. Just why do you have to use all the flowery language and all the confusing stuff? I don't know, but I'm more of an expository guy, and some of you are too, but some of you love poetry. And the reason you love poetry, and the reason poetry is really important for us, in all seriousness, is because poetry is the language of emotion and passion. Language of emotion and passion and beauty. And we can see things through poetry that we can't see through any other form of writing. There's actually one poem in this book, written by T.S. Eliot, it's his collection of poems, that compares a hippopotamus with the church at Laodicea. Only a poet could compare a hippopotamus with the church at Laodicea. This next book is the Great American Bathroom Book. Single sitting summaries of all-time great, I don't know how that got on my... Okay, this next one is Milton's, John Milton's Paradise Lost. It's an example of an epic. This is one long poem, if you can imagine. Adler says that epics are the hardest books to write, and his evidence for that is that there's only been 5 grand epics ever completed in all of the history of literature. I mean, it's an extremely difficult thing to do. Milton's Paradise Lost is one of these, an incredible poetic journey through the afterlife. Unlike anything else ever written. One of the things that Adler says about epics is that they're incredibly difficult to read, but they're worth persevering through. He says, along with the Bible, they constitute the backbone of any serious reading plan. That's an epic. An epic is very different from what's called history. This is Josephus' complete works. Josephus was a historian, very early on, a Jewish historian, who gave us a glimpse into the church from a Jewish perspective. Historians are storytellers and scientists at the same time. They tell us what they want us to know about a certain era of time. They are expository books as well. They want to convey knowledge about a certain period of human history. This next book is The Complete Plays of Sophocles. Raise your hand, do this for me. Raise your hand if you read a play during your high school years. Go ahead, raise your hand. Keep your hand up if you've read one since. Yeah, a couple of you have, yeah. Okay, so a handful of you did, great. Reading plays is hard too because, as Adler tells us, you don't have the whole story. You don't have the complete story. And so his hint for reading plays is really a cool one. He says, cast yourself as the director of the play. And cast the people in the play. So take Angelina Jolie, he didn't say this, but I'm saying it, and Brad Pitt, and Will Ferrell, and put them into the play and imagine them presenting the lines. And imagine them being the characters and tell them what to do. Give them direction and enter into the play from that way. And that way reading plays is a lot easier. This is a biography. It's a book I read a few years ago called The Rise of Theodore Roosevelt. Fascinating guy. Incredible story. A biography is another form of history, so it's another form of expository book. It's trying to convey knowledge, but not about an era of time, but about a specific person. There are 2 kinds of biographies. I don't know if you knew this or not. A definitive biography is written by an objective observer after someone has died, and they give you a really good comprehensive view of the person, both the good and the bad. An authorized biography is usually commissioned by the heirs, the children left behind, and they usually want them presented in a very positive way, so authorized biographies don't give you a full picture of the person, so I'd stay away from those if I were you. A philosophy book. Philosophers ask the questions that children ask. That's what philosophers do. Why are people? That's a question a child might ask, but it's a question a philosopher might ask as well. Is there a purpose to creation? Is there a purpose to humanness? These are kids' questions and philosophers' questions. Why are cats so aloof, yet dogs so warm and cuddly? Don't know any philosophers that have tackled that one, but I think they should. What philosophers do is they ask the questions and then they try to provide answers. Some are successful, some are not, most are not, but they're worth reading anyway. Here's Tabor's encyclopedic medical dictionary. This is called a reference book. Kids, this is what your parents used before Google was invented. And we don't use them all that often anymore. And so you're sitting there saying, Pete, this is somewhat interesting to a degree, but why are you going through all this? This is really important. These books are different genres. You read them differently, you interpret them differently, and you apply them differently. Remember, we're talking about observation, interpretation, and application of the Bible, right? Reading the Bible, interpreting the Bible, getting the meaning of it, and then applying it to our life. Here's what's really cool about the Bible. The Bible has 66 books in it, okay, from a totally different era of history all over the time. There are 7 different genres of books represented in the Bible. Most people don't realize this. 7 different forms or styles of writing, each of which have their own rules. So what I want to do with the time I have left, which isn't all that much, is I want to walk you through those 7 genres, because you will read the Bible differently depending on where those genres come from, okay? So I'm going to explain the genre to you. I'm going to give you the goal of each genre. I'm going to share one simple hint on how to read that genre. And then I'm going to give you the biblical examples, the books that fit into that genre. Don't try to take notes. Seriously. I have already produced these notes for you. And we have posted them online. If you go to btbf.org/the book, in fact, if you have your iPhone with you, you could do that right now if you want and find the notes right there. If not, you can log on tomorrow and print these off and put them in your Bible. I don't want you trying to scribble all this down. I've had some feedback that you're getting writer's cramp during my sermons lately. And so don't write it all down. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to have your Bible open, though, because I'm going to give you just one example of each of these genres and how we're going to read them. Are you in with me? Is that good? All right, here we go. Where'd my Bible go? There it is. Okay, the number one form of genre is called exposition. Exposition. This is like the expository category that Adler gave us for normal reading. Exposition is a straightforward argument or an explanation. It appeals to the mind. It's intellectually driven. There's a point-by-point logical progression. Many times it's legal in tone. Lawyers and attorneys love these parts of the Bible because they make logical sense. If you're just starting to study the Bible, this is a great place to start, because it's pretty straightforward, it's pretty simple. Turn in your Bible to James chapter 1, verse 2. I'll give you an example. James chapter 1, verse 2. Howard Hendricks says of expository or expositional books in the Bible that the meaning lies close to the surface. They practically outline themselves. These are the best places to start if you're starting to study Scripture. So here's an example, just one example of exposition. James 1, 2. Consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. If any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. And he goes on to talk about how to ask. And this is pretty straightforward, isn't it? Pretty simple stuff, but incredibly profound. Hey, don't bemoan suffering, because suffering leads to perseverance, and perseverance leads to character, and this is all good. There's not a whole lot of double meaning there. It's just pretty straightforward. It's exposition. It's fairly simple to understand. So here's the goal of exposition: agreement and action. James simply wants you to agree with him and put into action what he said. Agreement and action. The hint: when you're reading exposition, look for the argument in the paragraph and summarize it in one sentence. Read the paragraph and then just write in one sentence what he just tried to get across to you. What does he want you to agree with? What does he want you to be involved in? Examples of this in the Bible include Romans and Hebrews and James, 1st and 2nd Peter, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, Jude. These are all exposition books. And once again, this will all be on your notes when you download it from the internet. All right? Number two. A personal letter. I know you've received a personal letter at some point in your mailbox, someone that you know, someone that you love, and they write you a letter, and it's an encouragement to you, hopefully. There are personal letters in Scripture, too. It's kind of like a letter or an email sent to you by a mentor who is encouraging you in life and ministry. And some of the biblical writers did this for people that they were bringing along in ministry as well. Turn to 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 11. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 11. This is a great example of a personal letter. It's written from the Apostle Paul to his young protege, Timothy. What's cool about this is because it was inspired by the Holy Spirit, it doesn't just apply to Timothy. It applies to anyone who is in ministry throughout the ages. So it says in verse 11 of 1 Timothy 4, command and teach these things. Don't let anyone look down on you because you're young. But instead, set an example for the believers in speech and life and love and faith and impurity. Until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to preaching and to teaching. Do not neglect your gift, which was given you through a prophetic message when the body of elders laid their hands on you. Be diligent in these matters. Watch yourself, give yourself wholly to them so that everyone may see your progress. Watch your life and your doctrine closely. This was sent from Paul to Timothy. When I started here at Bentry, I was 28 years old. I'd never led a church before, and I was scared to death. And I lived in this passage right here. Practically every day I would come into my office, I'd open up my Bible to this passage, and I would read these words out loud. Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young. Instead of worrying about what people are thinking, Paul says, instead, focus on these things, your speech, your life, your love, your faith, and your purity. And that gave me some pegs to hang things on, some categories to focus on. And so this is became a letter from Paul to me. So here is the goal of these personal letters. It's personal mentoring in life and ministry from the people who wrote the Bible. How cool is that? You get emails from Paul and Peter and James. The hint is to read as though the writer has personally addressed this note to you. To read as though the writer has personally addressed this note to you. Some examples, 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, Titus. Paul also wrote letters to groups, house churches, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. So if you're in a small group and you want to know a book to read together and study together, read one of those because they were written from a mentor to a small group. And so there's a lot for you to glean together as a group there. Okay, third genre, story. Story. Narrative. Genesis, Exodus, Ruth, 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, Ezra, Nehemiah, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts. The Bible is full of story. Full of story. And I will go so far as to say very boldly that Leo Tolstoy has nothing on the Bible. I mean, the stories represented in this book are unlike anything else ever written in literature throughout the ages. Turn to 2 Samuel chapter 12. 2 Samuel chapter 12. I want to read you an example of story, an incredible example of story. I remember when I was learning in my English classes how to read story, my teachers taught me about plot, about the movement of story, about conflict and whether conflict was resolved or not. Those are some things to look for when you're reading story in Scripture. We're also taught to look at the characters, right? And ask yourself questions about the characters. Is this a good character or a bad character? Good, evil character? A good character or an evil character? Do I like this character or do I dislike this character? Is this character in conflict? If so, how are they resolving conflict or how are they avoiding conflict? Is this character making good choices or bad choices? All these questions you can ask so that you can glean about the character. And then the third thing that I've been taught when I'm reading story, especially in the Bible, is to ask, how does this story apply to my life? How does it agree with my scenario? Or another way to put it, if I were one of the characters in this story, which one would I be? And then put yourself in the story. Read your name as you're reading the story in the character that you think you would be and enter into the story, immerse yourself in it. In 2 Samuel 12:1, I told you 2 Samuel, didn't I? Yep, okay. There's two stories, actually. This is the story of David and his kingship, but in the midst of it, Nathan tells another story. So this is a very rich story passage. The Lord sent Nathan to David. Nathan was a prophet. And when Nathan came to David, he said, let me tell you a story, David. There were two men in a certain town, one rich and the other poor. The rich man had a very large number of sheep and cattle. But the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb he had bought. He raised it, and it grew up with him and his children. It shared his food, drank from his cup, and even slept in his arms. It was like a daughter to him. Now a traveler came to the rich man, but the rich man refrained from taking one of his own sheep or cattle to prepare a meal for the traveler who had come to him. Instead, he took the ewe lamb that belonged to the poor man and prepared it for the one who had come to him. David, hearing this story, burned with anger against that man. And he said to Nathan, "As surely as the Lord lives, the man who did this deserves to die. He must pay for that lamb four times over because he did such a thing and has no pity." And then Nathan said to David, say it out loud with me, "You are that man." And you could have heard a pin drop. Why did he say, "You are that man"? Because just before this, David had stolen a man's wife. That poor man only had one wife. David had tons of them. He was the guy who stole the little lamb from the neighbor. And in this story, David, his eyes opened up to the depravity of his sin. And he fell in repentance. Story is a powerful thing, an incredibly powerful thing. And the Bible is full of story. So what is the goal of story? Selected events are chosen to convey truth. They're trying to teach you truth. When they're telling the story of David, the authors don't tell you everything about David. They select certain parts of David's life to get across certain truths. And so the hint is to discern life lessons from the mistakes and victories of the characters. That's the best way to read story. Look at the characters, say, what did they do well? What did they do poorly? Where did they mess up? Where did they win? What was about their wins? And dive into the characters of the stories. Examples of story in Scripture include everything from Genesis to Ezra. That's a big chunk of the Old Testament. The Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Acts, and many other places as well. The fourth genre we're going to look at is called parable. Parable, a totally different kind of writing, although somewhat of a subset of story. There's story, and then there's short stories, right? Some of you love reading short stories because, well, they're shorter. And I get that. Parables are short stories. They're simple. They're memorable. They're retellable. They're about everyday things like fishing and working and food and family and working in the field. But as you're reading these stories about everyday things, the powerful theological and biblical truth just, bam, hits you upside the head. It kind of comes out of nowhere. Parables are a bit vague, so there's room for interpretation, so care is necessary when trying to draw out the meaning of parables. It was Jesus' favorite form of teaching, he tells us in Matthew chapter 13, verse 34. The goal of parable is this, to provide a window into the way things ought to be. To provide a window into the way things ought to be. We had Catalyst here last week, and before Catalyst started, they had some labs, and they had some other teachers come in, and my favorite lab was by Dr. Scott McKnight, who was one of my professors in seminary almost 20 years ago. And he did a session, and he talked about parables. And he said something that just opened up the world to parables for me. Here's what he said. We think that parables are illustrations of propositions, but they aren't. They are portals into Narnia. Ooh. Portals into Narnia. You know what a portal is? Like that little window on the side of a boat. It's like a little window into Narnia. What is Narnia? Narnia for him is the kingdom. It's the way things ought to be. And Jesus inaugurated the kingdom, and we see a little glimpse of it in this world. And what the parables are little glimpses into what the kingdom looks like. Little glimpses into Narnia. And the hint that he gave us, and I'm going to share with you when reading the parables, is to start reading each one with the words, imagine a world where. Imagine a kingdom where, because this is the way things ought to be. So we see a couple short stories, parables in Matthew 13. Don't turn there, I'll read it to you. They're very short. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure. Okay, so imagine a world, imagine a kingdom where a treasure is hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy, he went and sold all he had and bought that field. That's it. It's the end of the story. Then he goes on to tell another one, same point. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like, imagine a kingdom like this, where a merchant is looking for fine pearls. And when he found one of great value, he went away and sold everything he had, and he bought it. And that's the end of the story. No explanation. So what are those stories saying? Imagine a world where someone finds a treasure, hides it, goes and sells everything in order to purchase it. What is the treasure? What is the pearl? Well, the treasure and the pearl is the kingdom. And so the point, the simple point of these two stories is, okay, once you get a taste of the kingdom, everything in this world just fades to black. Everything pales in comparison. You don't mind giving up everything when you've had a taste of the kingdom because you know that's real life. What a great little lesson from two little stories. Examples of the parables are found mostly in the Gospels, mostly in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. We don't see many parables in John at all. Number five, poetry. Poetry. Did I mention a little earlier that I don't quite get poetry? But poetry is incredibly important because poetry is the language of emotion and passion and beauty. Whereas the exposition portions of Scripture appeal to those of us who are intellectually inclined, the poetry portions of Scripture appeal to those of us who are emotionally inclined. But whatever your inclination, you need both, because we are both emotional and intellectual beings, right? Right? No, yeah. Oh, okay, still there, good. Turn to Psalm 139, Psalm 139. I don't have everything, I don't have time to teach everything I wanted to teach you about poetry today. We'll get to it some other time. But there's one thing I want to make sure you understand about poetry. When I was in college, I was taking a test on figures of speech. I'll never forget it because one of my roommates was quizzing me. He hadn't taken the class. So he would say the figure of speech and then I'd have to give the definition and we were studying together this way. And he goes through this one and this one and this one. And then he finally gets to this one and he says, hyperbole. I said, what? He said, hyperbole. I said, that's not on there. He said, yeah, there's right there. And of course, it was hyperbole. And hyperbole is just enormous exaggeration. It's someone who is feeling something so intensely and so dramatically that they are just grasping for words, and they will choose any words they can, even if it's grossly exaggerated terminology, to convey what they're feeling, right? Please hear me. The Psalms are full of hyperbole. And if you don't know that, you might misunderstand exactly what the author is trying to convey. So let me give you an example. Psalm 139, verse 19. Psalm 139, verse 19. The psalmist says to God, if only you would slay the wicked, O God. Away from me, you bloodthirsty men. They speak of you with evil intent. Your adversaries misuse your name. Do I not hate those who hate you, O Lord, and abhor those who rise up against you? I have nothing but hatred for them. I count them my enemies. It's not very Christian. We read and we think, and then we say, you know what? Didn't Jesus tell us to love our enemies? Yeah, he did. He told us to love our enemies. Yet the psalmist here is saying, I hate my enemies. Oh, it's so different. Okay, genre matters, my friends. Jesus is teaching expository stuff. Pretty simple, love those who hate you. The psalmist is conveying his feelings. He's come across a group of people that hate God, and they don't hide the fact that they hate God, and they are blaspheming his name, and what the psalmist is saying is, hey God, I'm on your side. They hate you, they are your enemies, they are my enemies too. How can I find words to convey how deeply I feel this? I know, I abhor them. Is there a contradiction between Jesus and the psalmist? No. It's different genre. This is emotional language. That's intellectual language. Are you following me? See how important this is to understand? There's a certain genre of psalms called imprecatory psalms. Imprecatory psalms. These are the psalms that you're reading along and you're shocked one day because the psalmist says, oh God, I wish you would just crash and smash their heads against the rocks. And you're like, I hope my kids don't read this. Hyperbole. Hyperbole. Conveying anger passionately. So the goal of the Psalms, the goal of poetry is to appeal and move the emotions. Appeal to and move the emotions. I was taught this a number of years ago, and it's always been really helpful for me. The Psalms give you voice to what you're feeling. The Psalms give you voice to what you're feeling. You're like, what do you mean by that? When you're feeling really, really angry, go and start reading through the Psalms. Before long, you'll get to one where David was really, really angry. And as he's writing and you're reading, you'll say, that's exactly how I feel. I didn't know how to say it, but that's how I feel. And here's what's really cool. David felt that too. Whew. That's a relief. It's okay to feel what I'm feeling. It's okay to communicate to God what I'm feeling. Here's some words that I can just pray so I can tell God what I'm feeling. Psalms lend words to your feelings. They're such crucial portions of Scripture. Here's the hint for poetry. Read it or sing it out loud. Poetry is meant to be read out loud. Many of the Psalms are songs. They're meant to be sung. So get by yourself where no one will hear you. And just sing them. In fact, this is Adler's suggestion for reading even things like T.S. Eliot. Just read it out loud. Poetry is always meant to be read out loud. So read it out loud. It'll mean a lot more to you if you do. Number six. Only two left. Number six. Proverbs and wisdom literature. Proverbs and wisdom literature. The goal of Proverbs and wisdom literature is to instruct the inexperienced in wise living. To instruct the inexperienced in wise living. The writer assumes the position of a sage and the instructor of a younger, less mature student, basically trying to convey wisdom, wisdom that he has learned over the years. So the wisdom literature is not necessarily really theologically deep. It's very pragmatic about how to live life in this world. There's a caution that I want to make sure you hear. And many people make this mistake, and this will free you up as you're reading the Proverbs. Here's the caution. A proverb contains a principle, not a promise. A proverb contains a principle, not a promise. Turn to Proverbs 21:17. Proverbs 21:17. A proverb tells you how this life basically works, generally speaking. But then there's an unsaid qualifier, and that is, but it doesn't always work this way. It's a principle, it's not a promise. So we get to Proverbs 21:17, which says, he who loves pleasure will become poor. Whoever loves wine and oil will never be rich. And you read that, and if you think it's a promise, you say, huh, well, that's good to know. But it's not a promise, it's a principle. Generally speaking, if you squander your time, if you pour your energy and money into partying, you're going to end up poor. 9 times out of 10, you're going to end up poor. Generally speaking, it's a principle. If you find someone who's an exception to this rule, and we'll find them, won't we? Look at Hollywood, you'll see a whole bunch of them. People who have given themselves to pleasure and wine, and they are filthy rich. It happens every once in a while. But that does not contradict the truth. It simply contradicts the warning. You see the difference? The truth is still the same. Hey, 9 times out of 10, if you throw your life into partying, you're going to end up poor. It's a general principle. Here's the hint. Look for the general principle, not the specific promise, not a specific promise. Let me show you a really important verse where this is important to understand. Raise up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Principle or promise? Principle. A lot of people take it as a promise. So they pour their lives into their kids. Their kids head off to college, head off under the deep end, and they hold their Bible and they shake it at God. You promised me if I raise up my child in the way should they go, they wouldn't depart. You promised me. He didn't promise. Basically what he's saying is, hey, if you pour your life into your kids and raise them to know and love Jesus, there's a much better chance of them making it than not. Much better chance. So go for it. But remember, it's not a promise. Examples of wisdom literature are found in Job, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes. number seven, prophecy. Prophecy. Remember, Adler told us that the epic is the most difficult to write and the most difficult to read. I think if Adler were writing a book about the Bible, similar type of book, he would probably say prophecy is the most difficult to write and the most difficult to read. It's incredibly challenging. The reason is because two things are happening at once. There is a specific warning or judgment on the people of Israel who have rejected God. And then there's another fulfillment of something in the future that we don't quite know yet what it is. When we're reading, here's the hint for reading prophecy, we should read the passage bifocally. Bifocally. Which means we should understand that there's a specific application to the day in which it was written, and then we need to try and figure out what the future prophecy might be pointing to. Please hear me. This is a very dangerous place to be. It's very easy to get sucked into subjective thinking when you're looking at the fulfillment of prophecies, especially those that haven't happened yet. You can get really wrapped up into a lot of conversations that you don't need to get wrapped up into if you're not careful. Examples of prophecy include everything from Isaiah to Malachi, and then some in the historical books as well. There's a special category of prophecy. It's really its own genre, but I thought seven was pushing it, and eight, you guys would just rebel. So I'm just making it a sub-point under prophecy. It's called apocalyptic literature, apocalyptic literature. This is dramatic, highly symbolic, vivid imagery of the cataclysmic events of global proportions that bring about the end of time as we know it. It's highly symbolic. There's lots of light and power and movement and strange creatures. It's fertile ground for speculation. Fertile ground for speculation. And I just want to caution you, be very, very careful as you spend time in this portion of God's Word. Now, turn to Revelation chapter 9, verse 7. I'll show you one more passage. Revelation 9, 7. This is an example of apocalyptic literature. I'll tell you before I read it that one very popular interpretation of this text is that it's describing wartime helicopters in the end days. So maybe you'll see that, maybe you won't. The locusts looked like horses prepared for battle. On their heads, they wore something like crowns of gold, and their faces resembled human faces. Their hair was like women's hair, and their teeth were like lion's teeth. They had breastplates like breastplates of iron, and the sound of their wings was like the thundering of many horses and chariots rushing into battle. They had tails and stings like scorpions, and in their tails they had power to torment people for 5 months. This is where the helicopter things, there's the propeller on the helicopter, like a scorpion, and there's power, and that's how some people see this. They had as king over them the angel of the abyss, those whose name in Hebrew is Abaddon, and in Greek, Apollyon. Very vivid, very powerful, very imagery-rich language that conveys a simple truth. And here's the simple truth that it conveys. There is a cosmic struggle between good and evil, and God wins in the end. Amen. Amen. Thank you, sister. I got one amen. Can I say that again? There is a cosmic struggle between good and evil, and God wins in the end. Amen. Woo! Yes, the book of Revelation, which is the apocalyptic literature we have, will, in incredibly graphic ways, tell you that. So dive in, spend time, enjoy the imagery, enjoy the language, enjoy the message. Here is my hint to you. Focus on the whole and avoid the mire of detailed analysis, because that's where you can get sucked into argumentation. That's where you can get distracted from the message. The best example in Scripture of apocalyptic literature is the book of Revelation. So, we're out of time. Why did I do this? Because you don't want to go to the SAT prep book to answer the questions, why are people? Because this book won't answer that question. That's the philosophy book. But you don't want to go to the philosophy book to read a great story to get wrapped up into another world, because these books don't do that for you. Something like War and Peace will do that for you. But you don't want to go to War and Peace to get wrapped into a great epic poem about the underworld that doesn't do. You get the point. Different books do different things. So we read them differently, we interpret them differently, and we apply them differently. Same is true in the Bible. You don't go to James to find out how to vent your emotions. You go to Psalms for that. You don't go to Psalms to learn the intricacies of justification by faith. You go to Romans for that. You go to expository language for that. And as you dive into a scripture passage, one of the first questions you need to ask before you start reading is, what genre is this? And then you need to go to the little sheet you're going to print off from the internet tomorrow or this afternoon. You need to see what, that's right. Here's the goal of this genre. Here's the hint. And here's how I'm going to tackle this passage of scripture. Does that make sense? Please hear me. This will help you in the observation, interpretation, and most importantly, the application of what you're reading in scripture. So it's an incredibly important thing to learn. Please stand. I want to pray for you. Lord Jesus, I've done it again. I've fire-hosed my people. And they've been incredibly patient and listened well, and I'm grateful for that. I'm really grateful for that because I desperately want them to thoroughly enjoy reading their Bibles because it's in your word that you reveal your heart to us. And Lord, understanding how these genres work really helps us understand exactly what you're saying. So just take these truths and drive them deep into us so that we never read the Bible the same. We're always asking important questions of the text so that we can observe what you're saying, we can interpret what you mean, and in the power of the Spirit, we can apply what you say. That's our heart's desire. Please continue to do it in our midst. We pray these things in Jesus' powerful and precious name. Amen.